on his right hand side by Reg Parker, the chairman of the Rugby League. Himself, Reg Parker, a player here at Wembley with Barrow. And Mr. David Oxley, the secretary, just pointed them in the direction of home. And a nice touch. Arthur Bunting, the coach, allowed his assistant, Ken Fuchs, to take the honour today. And Lee Crooks, only 21 years of age, yet already the captain of the side. Kevin James from the Aberavon Club in Wales, Steve Evans and James Luluai. Dane O'Hara, his New Zealand co-patriot, all three, Fred Arcoy. And what an international flavour to this Hull side. Youngster Neil Puckering, John Muggleton from the Parramatta Club, and a man who need no introduction to Wembley viewers, Steve Norton, Gary Schofield and Gary Devoto. The Earl of Derby, tremendous interest in this game. His father before him was patron of the game. Coming across now, I think, to introduce to the Wigan side. An unusual situation. Wigan Club, the joint coaches, Colin Clark, an ex-forward, and just being introduced, Alan McInnes, school teacher at Marple Hall in Cheshire, brought a discipline and a keen fitness to the side. And Graham West, the captain, himself a grade one coach in the game, helps the two coaches, Danny Campbell. And Nicky Dutoit, the South African, watched the game on television in South Africa last year, rang the Wigan Club for a trial, and here he is on the team sheet. Ryan Case, good, strong prop forward. Nicky Case. Neil Courtney almost missed the game with injury. In scrum half, Michael Ford there, just to the introduced the Earl of Derby, perhaps having a chat about how he's going to mark Peter Stirling. I don't think he'll be bothered, this youngster, produced in the amateur game. And doesn't Brett Kenny look so casual? He looks confident. Well, he's probably used to the big occasion, this Australian Test standoff, played all over the world. Henderson Gill, Stevie Donlan signed just before the cup register deadline. £25,000. David Stevenson, I think Wigan will be putting the goal-kicking duties on him. And John Ferguson, they call him the wizard in Australia for Eastern Suburbs. And lastly, Sean Edwards at fullback. And the man we couldn't do without, Ronnie Campbell, the referee from Widnes. A nice touch from Widnes. They have been in Wembley as a rugby side for the last 7 out of 10 years. And Ronnie's had difficulty in getting the final, but at last he's got it. And the touch judges. And a nice touch this year, unusual. The international board are meeting in Paris this next week to discuss the future of the game. Mr. Sabumai from Papua New Guinea. Ken Arthurson there, just having a chat from Australia. Mr. Sopelsa from France. And the Papua New Guinea representative, Mr. Sabuma. Oh, they love that game in Papua New Guinea. huge roar, greets the sides again at the end of the national anthem. Perfect conditions for rugby league. We had a cool morning, dull and overcast, but the sun has broken through, shining now on the splendour of Wembley. 97,500 packed in there. I walked out of the hotel at 9 o'clock this morning, and the ticket touts were outside looking for tickets. The teams just being introduced to the crowd.
Number five.
Always nice for the crowd to applaud the favourites, and a huge roar from the Wigan section for Henderson Gill. Well, I don't know whether Brett Kenny wants to play. He doesn't look interested, but I'm sure beneath that casual air, there are some nerves. Michael, Neil Courtney, strong prop forward for Wigan. And Nicky Kiss, ex-Saddleworth Rangers amateur club in Oldham. Just got into the Great Britain squad this season. And another Great Britain squad member, Ryan Case, went on the last tour of Australia in 84. And for me, the main cog in this witness side, Graham West. Ryan Dunn just forced his way into the side this last couple of weeks. Both sides looking eager, looking keen. Hull just moving off now. Gary Kemble from New Zealand hasn't played since a serious injury in the semi-final replay at Headingley against Castleford, but he looks fit enough. And Kevin James, ex-Walesby, Aberavon Rugby Union, a player really impressed me this season. Dane O'Hara, ex-New Zealand captain from the Glenora club, 22 tries to his credit. Huge roar for Fred Arcoy, recovered from a broken jaw. And Lee Crooks, 21 years of age, skipper of the side. Sean Patrick, good hooker, local product. And John Muddleton, another boy from Parramatta, Australia. Paul Rose, well, his wife's watching this, she's expecting a baby, she'll be interested in this. And Stevie Norton, many times at Wembley, the ball distributor of this side. And the whole team, one or two shocks from coach Arthur Bunting there. James Luluai following his dislocated shoulder back in the side, but no place for Gary Schofield, the Great Britain centre. Steve Evans is preferred. And what surely must be one of the youngest front rows ever, Lee Crooks, 21 years of age, Sean Patrick, 22, and Neil Puckering at number 10, 19 years of age. Tremendous gamble by Arthur Bunting. But Wigan is a much more settled team. They've played together now for 2 or 3 weeks. Just John Ferguson flew back from Australia this week to take up his position on the wing at number 2. Fellow countryman Brett Kenny at standoff. He'll be making the play for the backs. And an interesting choice there on substitute, Nick Dutoit from South Africa. Phoned Wigan for a trial 12 months ago, and here he is at Wembley. And the man who's flown 12,000 miles, John Ferguson, Eastern Suburbs wingman, helped Wigan through the earlier rounds of the Challenge Cup. Prolific try scorer, has scored 22 tries this season. And Graham West, another New Zealand influence in the side. 6'5", tallest man to play at Wembley. Long reach, gives him the ability to get the ball away to his colleagues. And Neil Courtney missed the final last year when he was signed on, and chairman Jack Hilton was held up in the snow with his registration forms before the deadline. But he was determined not to miss this. And Michael Ford, local amateur rugby league product from the Oldham St Hans club, for my money got the toughest job in the game to mark Peter Stirling. Just about to toss up, Ronnie Campbell just telling the two teams exactly what he wants. And it's Graham West's choice, staying where he is. No real wind advantage. And there's the man, Peter Sterling. The shortest odds ever to win the Lance Todd Trophy as man of the match. The bookmakers in Hull wouldn't take any more bets on this man. And Steve Evans, a shock selection there ahead of the Great Britain centre Gary Schofield, but £70,000 worth of talent when Hull bought him from Featherstone. And number 10, 19 years of age, what an ordeal for this lad, Neil Puckering. But I saw him in the semi-final against Castleford, and I think this youngster is up to it. And Ronnie Campbell about to get underway, this 1985 Silk Cup Challenge Cup, and we're away. Long kick, and Sean Edwards to bring away. No real wind advantage to either side, the sun streaming down. Hull in the black and white, irregular hoops, playing from the right of our screens. And Alec, I think you've been down there, the atmosphere must be white hot.
Yes, it's white hot, Ray, and, you know, it's very, very warm out there, the sun's shining, and it should be a tremendous final. There's a real mean look about the whole side. They strolled on the ground, they look as though they've come to do a job, but Wigan looked so confident, it was unbelievable.
Good long kick, Gary Kemble. I think we'll see some good hard tackling from men there, like number 13 Wigan, Ian Potter, Kevin James. I like the looks of this lad since he signed from Aberavon. 14 tries to his credit. Hull on the attack, just 5 yards outside the Wigan 25. To Muggleton. Oh, good solid tackle from Graham West. And a penalty. Well, a penalty, Ronnie Campbell are judging that the tacklers were lying on the man at the play of the ball, not allowing him to get up. So a penalty against Brian Dunn. And first chance for Hull. And Gary Devorty, the substitute, bringing the now common bucket of sand to provide the mound. 30 yards. Straight in front of the posts. Lee Crooks taking a good long stride. Hasn't been the regular goal kicker this season. Only 25 to his credit. Well, he strikes it well, and it's there. 2 points to Hull, thanks to Lee Crooks. And the whole crowd's got something to shout about. Just inside. So Wigan already with a deficit in these early minutes. I think referee Ronnie Campbell there, Ali, just sort of stamping his presence on the game.
Yes, he was just saying that Graham West actually got hold of the ball forward round the head, and he thought it might have been a little bit dangerous because Graham West is 6'5", you know, and he's a very powerful man, and he could do some damage in that area.
Hull bringing the ball away through the forwards. Lee Crooks. We tend to think of this man, 5 test caps to his credit, as experienced, but he's only 21. Oh, good ball from Peter Sterling. A half break from Muggleton. This is the danger of this John Muggleton, number 11. Out on the outside, Hull on the attack then. Neil Puckering. And this Humberside team have really made a good start. Sterling, Norton. To Rose. Hull, of course, looking for their first ever win at Wembley. And up and under, it's a high one. Oh, well, he looked offside to me, but referee Ronnie Campbell, I think, spotted it, but allowed the play on when Sean Edwards, the Wigan fullback, got the ball. think these players playing a little bit of safety first rugby at the moment. Playing here at Wembley is unlike playing on the Northern grounds. Much bigger, much wider. Very still atmosphere down there. Just getting their bearings. Good ball from Ford to Kenny. Stevenson. Michael Ford. Pushing Hull back on the sixth tackle. Well judged by James. He's a powerful lad, this Kevin James. Difficult to put down, Alec.
Yes, and he looks as though he's very confident, Ray, as well. But just looking at the whole side, they look as though they've come here to do this job well. They're very confident. They're doing the basics right. They're getting the feel of the ball. But Wigan, I would think he'll come late in this game. They're a strong side, and I think they'll just keep plugging away.
Well, they're a very fit side, Alec, as we've seen during the season. 5 minutes gone still. That penalty goal from Lee Crooks, separating the sides. Hull 2, Wigan 0. Norton. Oh, Steve Evans, he's got some space. Just got Edwards to beat. To Kemble. Oh, he's lost it. Well, almost a chance there for Hull. Henderson Gill, lucky to retrieve that ball. And certainly, Peter Sterling and this whole side have put Wigan under pressure. 10 yards now from the Wigan line. But feeding. Referee Ronnie Campbell. Well, unusual to see Peter Sterling giving back chat there. Very disciplined player. But Ronnie Campbell standing no messing from him. Sent him back 10 yards. Watch it, says Ronnie. A player himself. Nicky Kiss to take the time.
Put the ball on the mark.
Oh, good solid tackle. Forward. Wigan skipper Graham West was saying before the game that he wanted to try to open the game out, but this whole defence is containing Wigan in midfield. To Potter. Ford looking for the kick. But well spotted by Crooks.
I think what we'll find here, Ray, in this game is that they'll keep an eye. We'll keep an eye on Brett Kenny because they know that everything stems from him. And if you know Fred Okoye, the hole number six, he's moving up very quickly and he's trying to take Kenny right out of the game.
Oh, good dummy from Sean Patrick, but an equally good tackle from Graham West. Good exhibition of second row play from West there, covering back Sterling now. To Okoye. Just couldn't get the ball out. Sterling again, this little man, he seems to be everywhere. Oh, good pass to Kemble, but dead. Worthwhile kick, he put some panic into John Ferguson, the Wigan number two, but it's this man Sterling already weaving his magic in midfield. And Wigan tap on the 22. Wigan, of course, who beat Dewsbury in that first final here in 1929 and looking to repeat the feat 50 years later. Four. Ooh, that was a risky ball. And it is. It's Hull ball. Hull seemed the sharper, seemed the livelier in these opening spells. Norton, Sterling, to Evans, ten yards now from the Wigan line, yes, a knock on. Difficult pass to take, Alec, that.
Yes, but the difference is right now that just looking at Hull, they look as though they've got the game together quicker than what Wigan have, and Wigan look as though, you know, they walked out very, very confident. I'm just wondering if they left a little bit of that confidence when they've been walking around, because they're not putting it together, they're not getting much chance to run with the ball, and Hull are closing them down very quickly.
It's early days yet, though, Alec, and Hull have had all the ball so far. And there's another scrum for them, one against the head. To Norton. He's got Muddleton with him. Evans. Looking very dangerous when they get this ball out to Steve Evans. A lot of Hull fans this morning were saying to me, a controversial selection, but he's certainly proving the point. Kevin James. 2 yards then now, from this Wigan line. Sterling. Arcoy. Oh, oh, yes. I think Fenn Arcoy's dummy there. He even beat his own man. Obstruction. Yes, crossing in front of Arcoy. Referee Ronnie Campbell right on the spot. 10 minutes gone. This first half still 2 points to nil for Hull. Ooh. Well taken by Dan O'Hara. Could you can't afford to miss kicks like that, Alec?
Well, I'm just wondering, Ray, last year some of these players froze from Wigan. I'm just wondering if we're going to see a repeat performance of this, because David Stevenson, who normally a very good kicker, should find touch from where he just put that ball.
Well, it's put Hull back on the attack. And this youngster, Neil Puckering, 19 years of age, driving in. Sterling, all good cross ball to Crooks. Oh! Just on the line. Yard from the line, hold in, on the attack. Sterling again. Arcoy, back to Sterling. Well, he's doing everything, is Nicola. Muggleton. Gary Kemble, he's got a 2-1 situation. Kevin James, and he's in. First try of the match. Kevin James took his opportunity well. But I think it was engineered by Peter Sterling. Kept the ball going, moving it out. But Kevin James was on hand, spotted the gap.
Well, this is, they've been threatening to do this all the time. Oh, look at the little man again. Peter Sterling slips the ball out here to Muddleton, who throws the ball out here to Gary Kemble. Gary Kemble draws Henderson Gill. Perfect timing, Kevin James. What a way to celebrate first appearance at Wembley.
Yes. Kevin James, 15th try of the season. That'll set a few hearts going in Aberavon. A tricky kick for Lee Crooks. One of the problems for goal kickers here is that since they put the roof on the stadium, the wind, if there is one, tends to swirl around, but hardly any wind out. Pressure on Crooks. Already kicked one penalty. Oh, he struck it well, but no, not got the direction. So,
well, this is it, Hull here. Just watch as they get the ball in. They're slipping the ball in the tackling. Sterling, what a little player this fella is. John Muddleton holds the ball. Gary Kemble, watch this, perfection. Kevin James, what a way to celebrate. What a very important try.
Wigan then to restart, 6 points to nil down. Stevenson, a long one, hoping to push Hull back. We haven't really seen Wigan in any attacking mood yet. Gary Kemble, thankfully recovered from a tackle in the semi-final against Castleford, the replay. James Luluai, another one who has been one of the many injured players for Hull, dislocated a shoulder 3 weeks ago. Oh, good driving, solid run. Very quick, speedy player, Luluai. Sterling. Long, breaking kick. Oh! Well, I think the bounce from that kick from Sterling beat Sean Edges more than anything. I was on the pitch yesterday afternoon, and both Alec Murphy and I commented on how hard this pitch was. I think they've had less rain down here than we've had in the north. And that bounce beat youngster Sean Edwards. And it's a whole ball again. To Arcoy. Evans again. And it's this scrum possession from Hull that's doing all the damage to Wigan. Steve Norton. Oh, good timely interception from Steve Downing. And I think that will give Wigan some relief, Alec.
Well, I think they've got to have some relief, Ray, and they've got to have some help as well, because they've very rarely been in the old half, and the whole tackling is absolutely first class. They're covering across, they're taking two men every time, and when they get the ball, they're saying, well, we can run with it, but when you've got it, we're going to knock you down.
Yes, and we've not really seen Wigan out of this sort of 30, 35-yard area so far. What a penalty. Again, Ronnie Campbell signifying, lying on the tackle. Player. Referees this season been very keen about this. Want to allow the player to get up very, very quickly and put to touch. It's David Stevenson there. And Nicky Kiss. To Kiss. Forward. Oh, good ball from Brett Kenny. Oh! Michael Ford, well picked up. Stevenson taking the ball on his own. Had a very good career, this boy, David Stevenson, since joining Rugby League from the Fylde Rugby Union Club. Oh, good move from... Well, it looked a little high, that tackle, but referee Campbell said the shoulder. Potter to Dunn. And the sixth tackle coming up. Back to Kenny. Oh, good ball to Ferguson. Oh, he's beat two men, he can run this boy. A spectacular run. Oh, what an equally spectacular tackle from Gary Campbell. We talked about this man, they call him the Wizard at Eastern Suburbs in Sydney. Flown over last weekend. And what a run.
Well, this is what they brought this fella over to him. Just watch Brett Kenny as he gets the ball. He rolls it. John Ferguson is absolutely lethal from this distance. He's flying down the wing. A brilliant tackle coming off here from Gary Campbell. And what a try saver.
And that set Wigan going. Huge. 40,000 contingent roaring them on now. Case. Edward. Oh, good ball to Gill. Has he got the strength? No. Another good tackle from Gary Campbell. Well, I think if Hull win this match, these two tackles on either flank from Campbell, they've contributed a lot. But Wigan now, 5 yards from the Hull line. First real threat we've seen from Wigan. Forward to Dunn. Oh, he's almost through. 10 yards now from the Hull line. Sixth tackle. Forward. Looking for Kenny. Back to Potter. To Ferguson again. They're looking for this man, the danger. And he's in! Majestic piece of rugby. He got the ball in a standing position. A brilliant sidestep. As they say in the North, he could sidestep on a threepenny bit, this lad. Wonderful piece of rugby.
Well, 13,000 mile, and was it worth it? Brett Kenny has the ball here. He just holds the ball. He shakes off a tackle here. Good thinking from Ian Potter here. A long ball to John Ferguson. Just watch the shimmy. Leaves Dan O'Hara for dead. Flies round him. 13,000 mile. I think the Wigan fans will think this trip is very well worth it.
Well, I think the airfare return from Australia is about £750. And that's the best £750 Wigan have spent this year. John Ferguson, the Wizard from Eastern Suburbs. Brilliant wing play. A shimmy inside, sidestep outside. And that's put Wigan back in the game. And Henderson Gill to take the kick. I think many people felt that Wigan could have a problem here. Regular kicker, Whitfield, not been selected. With Henderson Gill scheduled to take the kicks from the right-hand side. He'll be hoping to sweep this round in. Does he? And he does. Good kick. Flags in the air. Henderson Gill, 2 points.
Well, this is just... watch a little shimmy on this John Ferguson. He's a very strong lad, he's very fast, and that's the best wingman in the world he's just run past. And what a great try.
And Well, people said that with the stars in this match, we must have a spectacular game, and already I think we have. And Colin Clark, Alan McInnes look a little more settled now on the Wigan bench. Ian Potter. Nicky Kiss just settling it down. Very often when a side has scored a try, they get a little bit giddy. Back to Dunlop. Long one, a high one, oh, but well taken by Kemble. Gary Kemble quite content to bring the ball out just to meet the opposition, allow his forwards to regroup. Kevin James doing the same, absorbing two tackles, very much like forming a ruck in rugby union, bringing the pack in, bringing the players in, and then letting it go wide.
I think, Ray, if there is a problem with this whole side, is that they've had a tremendous amount of injuries, and if there's ever anything going to find them out, this pitch will, because it's a graveyard for players who are not 100% fit, and Wigan are a very, very fit side indeed.
We couldn't have anything more even. 20 minutes gone in the first half. 6 points each. Henderson Gill. And those two tries we've seen, when we consider the force of the tackling like that there from those prop forwards, well, the tries were well worked. To West. See a lot of energy sapping here in this heat now, Ali.
Yes, and just then, Ray, by putting these balls long down the field, the problem is you've got to kick the ball into space, because with this Gary Kemble at fullback now, he runs well with the ball and he's liable to gain 20 and 30 yards.
Steve Evans. A lull in the stadium, in the crowd now, at 6 points each. Both sides grappling for that dominant role, neither side able to get it. Arcoy. Well, it's anybody's. Ian Potter. Product of the Blackbrook Amateur Club, along with Brian Case here taking the ball. What a proud day for the Amateur Club. To Muddleton. Likes to roam out wide, this John Muddleton. Picked up plenty of tries this year at Hull by keeping on the flanks. To Sterling. Weaving, dodging. Not throwing it anywhere. Stevie Norton. Oh, he's got a gap. A knock-on. But if Lee Crooks could have taken that pass from Steve Norton, well, there looked to be a try on. This is the danger of this loose forward. Wigan ball. To Edwards, linking up to Kenny. Oh, good ball to Donlan. Just couldn't get away. Nice link up there by youngster Sean Edwards, hoping to make the overlap.
Very interesting to see Brett Kenny, Ray, where he's standing. He's actually standing wide and using the blind side quite a lot, because they seem to think that when they get the ball out, Hull are a little bit vulnerable on the flanks.
Michael Ford. Having a good game, this youngster, Michael Ford. Not unnerved. And Brett Kenny, the man who'll be pushing these ball out wide. There he is, he's got the gap. Well policed. Wigan now, looking lively. Oh, that looks to be a good kick. And it is a telling kick. Michael Ford, an excellent kick. Kept it low to the ground. Just beat Gary Kemble. Says a lot of work for his forwards. And a lot of people said that this whole front row of Crooks, Patrick and Puckering would be too young and might lose the nerve, but they've been winning the scrum so far. referee Campbell wanting a good scrum. And Wigan ball against the head. Brett Kenny. Oh. Fred Arcoy just getting hold of him. But Wigan on the attack. Michael Ford to Ferguson. Keeps it going. Stevenson. Nice to see both these sides moving the ball out, giving us an open game. Well, whole ball and a penalty. Referee Campbell interfering at the play of the ball. And a kick in a very kickable position. And it'll be interesting to see who takes this. It's David Stevenson. Wigan agreed that Henderson Gill would take them on the right-hand side and David Stevenson on this left-hand side. An easier kick than his colleague Gill's. He's taking his time. The pitch was very, very hard. Not an experienced kicker, Stevenson. Only 30 goals this season. But a strong lad to get a good thwack behind the ball. He does. But he misses it. It's chances like that that go begging.
Well, this is what the incident is for here. As the ball is being played, just watch John Muddleton, the number 11. Now, Hull will think they're being badly done to here because he plays it by. John Muddleton rolls the ball back, but he also obstructs David Stevenson from coming through.
Yes, I think it's the obstruction holding him, Alec, as much as kicking at the ball that was the problem.
Yes, and I said before, Ray, that you cannot go into a Wembley final without an experienced goal kicker. David Stevenson really counter, will it be very important?
Well, this man's certainly come from Australia, not for a holiday. He's determined to get into the game, John Ferguson. To West. To Kenny. Oh, good ball from Kenny. He's got space. Can he make it all the way? He's going round Gary Kemble. And he does. Superb try from Brett Kenny. He took the one chance that's been offered him so far. Showed the pace. And a wonderful moment for those Wigan fans.
This is absolutely world-class. A beautiful ball here from young Michael Ford. And this is rugby league at its very best. This is the number one in the world. And this is one of the number one tries. What a great try. And what a big occasion. What an absolute... No wonder this man was sulking and had his hands in his pockets. I bet he's jumping with joy now.
Yes, we saw how casual, cool and laid back he was. Well, he certainly excited the Wigan fans. And another chance for David Stevenson. In exactly the same position. And goal kicking is a vital art here at Wembley. The currents in the air and the wind tend to swirl around. We don't have any window here, but the air currents are moving about. And goal kicking very often is the key factor in who wins the cup. And it's there this time. 12 points to 6 for Wigan.
Well, this is good football by Wigan. A lovely ball from Mickey Kiss to young Michael Ford. Number one here, and again to Ford. And just watch Brett Kenny. He might have had his hands in his pockets when he walked out, but I wish all, I bet all would think now, I wish he's got him in now, because is he going for a try? This is a brilliant try. Runs round Campbell. He's not slouching about now, and I think that's made Wigan very, very happy indeed.
Kick from Lee Crooks, and both sides prepared to move the ball about, seeing some spectacular rugby, wonderful passing. Interesting to see how these Australians, like Sterling and Muggleton kick at the play of the ball. It is allowed in the laws, but we don't see much of it in this country. Wigan now content, I think, just settling it down, putting Hull back in their half. Using the kick through before the sixth tackle complement is up. Wigan had a very good defensive record in the league this season. Quite content, I think, to contain Hull down here, deep in their own half. Arcoy. Nice to see Fred Arcoy come back from a serious jaw injury. To Knott. Evans. Hull, of course, reaching Wembley here, needing two replays in the third round before they beat Widnes 19-12, and another replay in the semi-final against Castleford, 22-16, had a lot of rugby and a lot of injuries. Well, Colin Clark and Alan McInnes, they don't look too happy. I don't think they're relaxed till 4:30. Well, and he's looking at his watch already, he's calling. Peter Sterling. Oh, he's got the nice side break. Oh, a good job. Henderson Gill was there, and he might well turn round and grin. I think that saved the try, Alan.
Yes, and that's two great chances Hull have threw away, because that was the first tackle, Ray. But I'm just looking at one or two of these Hull forwards. The legs are looking a little bit heavy, and if they have got players on there who are not quite 100% fit, definitely this ground will find them out.
Well, you're possibly right there, Wigan. Have had the easier passage, Alec. They, no replays. They beat Backley in the first round, Warrington, Bradford, and then Hull Kingston Rovers in the semi. So they could be the fresher team. Kemble to O'Hara. Well, he shrugs off Nicky Case. Strong running wingman, this chap from the Glenora club in Auckland. Sterling again to Paul Rose. Paul Rose, number 12, said that this would be his last game of rugby league, retiring after this. Sterling again at the Hubble Fund, midfield. Lee Crooks. Not seen a lot of Lee Crooks so far, but very dangerous forward near the line. Good ball handler. Sterling again. To Arcoy. Oh, good tackle there from Neil Courtney. Good prop forward work. Oh, and up and under. It's a nice one. But it's a penalty. Referee Campbell bringing Nicky Kiss out. Just 8 minutes to go in this first half. Having a word with Kiss, having a word with Kiss. Some interference, I think, after the kick was made. And it's silly interference from Kiss, because it's presented Hull with a very kickable opportunity. And Peter Sterling saying to referee Campbell, yes, we're going for it. Crooks then looking for the second goal, and he finds it, simple enough. So 7 minutes to half time then. Lee Crooks tacks another 2 points on there, much to the delight of the Hull fans. 12-8. To James. Well, I think we've already seen the quality of the wing play in this match, with James and O'Hara on the Hull side and Gillan Ferguson on the Wigan side, and to the credit, both sides moving the ball out to the wings. Stephen Orr. Interesting to see Nicky Kiss there clamping the ball. He knows that Stephen Orr can hold that ball and get the pass away with one hand. Still, Crooks, I think Hull at the moment, Alec, a bit overdoing this sort of Sterling short ball to the forwards.
Well, I don't think they're overdoing the Sterling bit, but I don't think they've got there as much pace as Wigan. I think every time they move the ball and support the man, they look as though they're going to make the break. But Wigan look as though they've got that extra yard in pace.
And the first turnover of the game, after six tackles, the ball handed over to the opposition. To Nicky Kiss. Graham West. Both sides seem quite content to keep the ball in the forwards at the moment. Brian Dunn. Michael Ford looking for another one of those long raking kicks. Oh, and he finds it again. Second kick there from Ford that we've seen this afternoon. An old head on young shoulders. And Arthur Bunting, well, he looks concerned. I think he's criticising the O'Hara wing there for not covering the kick. And Peter Sterling to put the ball in. Scrum that Hull need to win. They're losing the scrums, level them there at four each. And Brian Case, number 10, the prop was out quick. To Paul Rose. Sterling, Crooks. Ooh! Ooh, that's what you call a tackle from Neil Courtney. Sterling again. Arcoy. Very impressed with this Wigan defence, Alec.
Yes, it's very good defensively, but I'm just wondering now, I'm just looking at one or two of the players, looking at Graham West, the Wigan number 11. He looks to me as though, you know, he's the Wigan captain, and he'll be talking, but just looking at him now in the game, he's bending down on the floor, it's taking him a good 5 minutes to get up off the floor, but I'm just wondering whether he's saying to the lads, look, we'll settle for the 8-12 advantage.
Paul Rose. Turn up. Oh, looking for the wing there, I think. He was looking for Kevin James outside him. You can never take your eye off this man. Sterling. Muggleton. Wigan keeping a very close eye on this number 11, John Muggleton. The second roll from Parramatta. Good turn of speed. Wigan certainly won't let Hull score now, just before the half-time. 3 minutes to go to the half-time hooter, they want to hold out. Six tackle coming up. Will it be a Sterling chip kick? It is. He's following it. Oh, well taken by Sean Edwards. And he scrambled over the line, of course, in rugby league. If Sean Edwards had been tackled behind the line, that would have been a dropout and possibly possession to Hull. I don't think Joe Ferguson was aware when he played that ball that there was nobody there. But a penalty from the referee for nudging at the play of the ball. And that could have been a little bit of a scare for Wigan there when Ferguson played that ball. A sliced ball there from David Stevenson, but I don't think he'll be too bothered. 5 yards or 10 yards, doesn't matter here at this stage. He just wants possession. These players will know that the half-time is coming up. He'll absorb two or three forwards, driving in. They'll use the six tackles up on these forwards. Wigan bringing the whole pack closer in midfield. Not good professional tactics here from Wigan, taking the ball in front of the post. Normally a side would take it away from the post to avoid any goal kicks. Oh, beautiful ball from Kenny, which puts Stevenson in space with Gill outside him. He's only got Kendall, the fullback, to beat. He's got the strength, he's got the speed, and he's beaten him. Oh, as good a try as we'll see. All made for Ennison Gill by that beautiful pass from Kenny. We said at the beginning about that man's silken skills. and Nightingale going all the way. Tremendous run. And just look at the grin on that. A feast of rugby. But I'm sure Brett Kenny there, that's the man he owes that try to, having a word with him. He ran onto the ball well. And I think Kenny's saying to him, look, I'll draw them in and push the ball out wide. You do the running, I'll do the thinking. And he loves it. Great character, plays to the crowd. Wigan signed him from Rochdale Hornets for £30,000. And a tremendous capture for them. ...16-8 for Wigan now. It gives Wigan that strong advantage of making Hull score twice. 40 minutes are up. David Stevenson. He lofts it, but not got the direction again. Just to the left of the post. But there's the hooter. And a satisfactory half from Henderson Gill. Wigan in the lead, 16 points to 8. A tremendous piece of rugby there. Henderson Gill got the balance, got the strength, and just look at the speed that he shows there. Determination. There's nobody going to stop me, says Henderson. It's a try all the way. Covering from Gary Kemble, and remember that this lad Kemble, he can run. What a despairing dive. And it's sheer strength, I think, that takes Gill through. Pounds away, the size of those thighs, and he's over. No problems. Brett Kenny, nice to see, having a word with this youngster, number 7, guiding him through the game. But I think Ford's doing as much as Kenny, and it's this half-back combination that's winning this match. Wigan, I'm sure, delighted to go in there as the guards come out, but at 16 points to 8, a lot of credit to Wigan. To go yet, 40 minutes of this second half. Many a side have come back, Alec, I think.
Yes, but it's going to be a very, very big job for Hull, Ray, because I've just loved to hear what Arthur Bunting had to say. I wanted to win this one so badly because this is the third time they've been to Wembley and not brought the cup back, and those Humberside supporters will be very, very disappointed.
To James. Yes, I think that the difference has been speed between the two sides in that first half, not only on the flanks down the wings, but the back three forwards have done, Potter and Graham West for Wigan. They're finding the gaps, they're finding the half chances, and the two halfbacks, Ford and Kenny, they're making the most of them. Yes, stealing the ball. Referee Ronnie Campbell had shouted helm. When the referee has said that, you can't steal the ball. Penalty against Nicky Kiss. Oh, a good high kick. Good kick there from Lee Crooks. And I don't think we can criticise the whole tackling. It's just the quality of the play on it.
Well, Ray, let's be honest. This has been it's an absolutely magnificent game. The weather is absolutely superb. The game is even better. And all I've got to do now is say, well, they can score 3 tries, so can we. They've certainly got to pull something out.
Well, they've got the players to pull something out. And skills of people like Fred Arcoy, Sterling, Norton in these backs to Muggleton. Sterling again, first receiver. Long, well, well taken by Lee Crooks. Just outside the Wigan 25 yard. To Norton. Looking to turn inside. Can't give this loose forward an inch. Sterling again. Muggleton. And the sixth tackle coming up. Sun streaming down on the pitch. Oh, it's a tricky one for young Edwards to take. But well taken by his colleague, Michael Ford. No, it was Brett Kenny. Good take from Kenny. Well, he's into everything. He's making tries, he's saving tries. But nothing seems to bother him. Wigan content just to play the ball amongst the forwards. Nicky Kiss, oh, good run from Kiss there. to Stevenson. Interesting to see Wigan kicking this ball deep, Alec, containing Hull.
That is exactly why, Ray, because things like that can happen at Wembley. And Kevin James, the lad who's got the ball now, I bet he wishes he could, the ground would open up and swallow him. But Wigan realise they've got that extra yard in pace. So they think we better play this game down in the Hull half, because there's nobody on the other side who can go the full length of the field.
Well, we'll see. Michael Ford to put the ball in for Wigan. And he does. He gets it. Oh, beautiful dummy from Kenny. He's got Sean Edwards linking up with him. Has he got the legs to the line? And he has. Oh, tremendously well-worked try. Youngster Sean Edwards spotting the gap. The run-around movement setting those Wigan fans in raptures. I don't think they can believe the quality of the play.
Well, you just talk about class, and this is what it is. This is absolutely sheer class. You'll never see a better standoff in the country if you've ever seen one. Little Sean Edwards, he'll love this. He's pleased with this. He's only 18, and I'll tell you what, he'll always treasure this one.
Yes, and all credit to that youngster, Sean Edwards, the youngest player last season to play at Wembley. Back again this year for revenge, and 20 points to 8 for Wigan. Well, I must confess, I myself thought it would be a very high-scoring final, but I thought it would be 2-4 to either side. And Gill with what should be a comfortable kick. And it's a good one, 22 points to 8.
Well, this is it again. This fella is 3-1 to win the man of the match, the Lanscott Trophy. I don't think he'll have any problem. He's sheer class. He just strolls through. He's even got time to have a look round. Lovely supporting play by Sean Edwards. The little fella will love this. He'll relish this for a long, long time. And as he make one, made no mistakes. What a great try.
Yes, and Hull kick off knowing that 22-8, they're looking to be in line for the last time they were beaten by Wigan here in 1959. 30 points to 13 then, they still smart from that defeat. Hull vainly trying to get back into the game. Crooks looking for support, but the Hull forward's just not backing up like the Wigan contingent. Peter Sterling, he's got a gap. He can make it himself if he goes. Oh, good try to Evans. Yes. I thought Peter Sterling was going himself. Steve Evans a little disgruntled about that tackle by Brian Dunn. And good referee there.
Well, we've got Mr. Magic on one side, and what can you say about this? This fella must be the best scrum half in the world. They've also got the best standoff. Just look at this for class. Knows he can't get there himself, but he holds the ball and releases it. And for Steve Evans, we'll have the easiest of chances.
And Evans did very, very well to back up there. And let's not just praise that man's skills, but let's just think of the strength of Peter Sterling. He's only 5 foot, he's 11 stone two, and yet he held off the opposition to put that ball back inside. And an injury there, it looks to be Steve Evans, and I think that was the knock that he got when he was complaining about Brian Dunn's tackle as he went over the line. But of course, in rugby league, the game continues despite injuries. And a very difficult kick for Lee Crooks. Already kicked two penalties on the 25-yard line, right on the touchline. But I've seen this lad kick these before. Oh no. Not a kick like that. Top the ball.
Well, a lot of people say that I give this fella far too much recognition, but just look at this for class. What can you say about the man? He walks through three men as though he's not there. He knows he can't get there. He knows he's going to be tackled, but just which way? Wow, he changes the ball in his other hand, slips it out to Steve Evans. Good supporting play and a very good try.
22-12 then. 7 minutes gone in this half, 33 minutes to go, and I still wouldn't like to put my money on either side. To Gary Kendall. And certainly the the neutral observers in this crowd, really getting their money's worth. This huge 97,500 crowd swelled by people from all over the country come to see this spectacular. To Crooks, coming more and more into the game now, this prop forward Lee Crooks. Very experienced player, even though he's only 21. Oh, good ball to Arcoy. Coach Arthur Bunting picked this man Arcoy to mark Brett Kenny. Oh yes, good kick. And Peter Sterling says, anything Wigan can do with Michael Ford, I can do better. 45-yard probing kick. And what a tremendous duel at it between these two halfbacks, both teammates for the Parramatta
well,
club in
Australia.
To
be honest, Ray, I'm very glad that they're not playing together on the same side today. This fella, for me, he's got to be the number one scrum half in the world. But if we're going to show any signs of getting back into this game, they've got to do it now, because Wigan will come stronger and stronger. Because as the game goes on, they're the fitter of the two sides, and they'll just keep carrying it on.
Well, they look to be coming back now, just inside the Wigan 25. And this man, Stephen Orton, can he make the forwards tick? He retired last year, but came back this year, had a good season. Oh, Wigan have stolen the ball. To Ferguson. When you're trying to get back in the game, you can't allow to let the ball loose like that.
I think we might have a problem here, Ray. I think we might see a substitution with John Ferguson, because I watched him coming down out of the tunnel, and I think he's carrying a leg. I think he's got a knock on his ankle, and I think I wouldn't be surprised if Colin Clark didn't bring John Ferguson off and bring Detroit on, because he has got a knock on his leg, and he is limping pretty badly.
Yes, but I think the coaches will be very loath to bring him off. He's got such talent. Oh, well picked up by Edwards. Oh, and a nice sidestep. What a confident youngster this lad is. Ex-England Schools Rugby League and Schools Rugby Union. Ferguson. And I think Ian Potter there suddenly found the ball in his hands and said, well, I'm getting rid of this. 10 minutes gone, Wigan still 10 points in the lead, 22-12 in their favour. To Steve Knoll. Sterling. Oh, and Ferguson's got the ball, he's got away. And it must be a try, this. The scamper's home, no problem. And another 4 points to Wigan. What an opportunist this man is. Picked the ball up from nowhere. And he set the Wigan contingent to light. Edwards there.
Well, Dana Ware is having an absolute nightmare. He should have picked this ball up, but you don't give this fella these kind of chances. Just watch him go. Gary Campbell almost gets to him, but is this fella determining him? What a great wingman, and what a very, very, very good try. He's not satisfied with that. He goes round the post as well.
And his opposite wingman, Henderson Gill, to take the kick. We saw some excellent wingmen in the parade of stars who paraded in the 50 years at Wembley before. The legendary Australian Brian Bevan, 796 to his credit. Jim Luthwaite from Barrow. And what an exhibition these two wings are putting on for Wigan. Ferguson with the running, Gill with the running. And here, Henderson Gill with the goal kicking. It's there. Another 2 points from Gill.
Well, just watch Sterling here as he gets the ball. You know, Dana Ware is having an absolute nightmare. But John Ferguson, quick back, quick thinking. And how does he do this? How does he think like this? Does he want to score? Does he think this is important? And just look where he wants to go. Right behind the sticks.
We said earlier on that Hull was smarting at a 30-13 defeat against Wigan in 1959, but They've got to do something about it. The highest defeat ever at Wembley was by Hull again in 1960 when they lost 38 points to 5 to Wakefield, and I'm sure they won't want to be reminded of that. Wigan, Michael Ford. Pushing hold back again with a grubber kick. Good bounce for Gary Kemble. But interesting to see that when Gary Kemble picks the ball up, the Wigan cover is up very, very fast. And particularly that youngster, number 7, Ford. Sterling looking for the blind. He's got support. Good ball to Muggleton. Back to Norton. Oh, good rugby from Norton. O'Hara. Just not got the pace on the outside hole, but Norton and Sterling creating the game to our corner. Oh, beautiful ball to Lulawai. Oh, he's going to run for the line. Well picked up by Crooks. Evans. And good defensive play from Henderson Gill. All credit to Hull. Well, it looks a penalty. Not playing the ball. Just throwing the ball, Steve Evans, between his legs, yes. Not playing it with the foot. And Arthur Bunting, well, he must be wondering, do I gamble, do I put the substitutes on as the Hull coach? He's got some thinking to do. Chewing on his cigar. You can't make mistakes like that at the play of the ball, Harry.
Well, you can't make mistakes like that, but did you see Arthur Bunting's face then? I'll tell you this, Ray, I think if Wigan scored another try, he'll eat that cigar. I don't know about smoke it.
Ryan Case. Kenny. Ian Potter just bringing the ball gently over that 25-yard line. And Wigan fans already singing, chanting, here we go, anticipating a victory in this Silk Cup, Challenge Cup final. Will we have Ford kicking again? This time Stevenson. And it's a penalty. A penalty, I think. Obstruction at the kick. Danny Campbell, big, rough, tumbling New Zealand forward. And Brian Case, number 10, to come off. Brian Case has had knee ligament trouble. I think he's done very, very well to last out so far, Brian Case. And this man, Danny Campbell, he broke a leg 12 months ago, made a tremendous recovery. 16 stone, rough and tumble forward from New Zealand. I think Wigan will use him to drive a few wedges down the middle. Nicky Kiss. To West.
I was thinking last night, Ray, when the lads was having a couple of pints in the bar, they said this would be a big score, but surely nobody could have expected a game as good as this. There's been some tremendous rugby, and Wigan really have played so well. They've really lit the occasion.
Yes, and I don't think many people back in Humberside will relish that Wigan also beat Hull Kingston Rovers in the semi-final as well. And here they are, leading in this final. Further honour at stake for both of these two clubs too is that in August, to celebrate a year of sport for the Isle of Man, the winners of the Challenge Cup will play the champions, very similar to the Charity Shield in soccer. O'Hara. To Norton. Early. Muggleton. not really found the gaps of this Parramatta second row. John Muggleton. Sean Patrick. Interesting battle between those two number nines. Patrick and Kiss. No. Well, I think two opportunities there from Peter Sterling. But here are two more opportunities coming on. Number five, O'Hara, going off, and Neil Puckering, number 10. Gary Schofield coming on. Well, many thought that this Great Britain youngster should have been on at the beginning. And Gary Devorty. Oh, another good dummy from Brett Kenny. To Donlan. But good reading there from Kevin James. Came in from the wing. Cut the centre out. Ferguson. He's a bit like an electric eel, this Ferguson. He's wriggling, moving, weaving. Danny Campbell. Yes, this is the job that I think the Wigan coaches have brought him on. Blockbusting down the middle. And done. To West. Gary Devorty, the whole substitute, just clamping Graham West with the ball. No, not quite. I think that was well-intentioned of David Stevenson there. He just tried to flick the ball onto John Ferguson, but didn't come off. Gary Devorty, the youngster, packing down in the second row, the substitute. To Hull. Oh! A little bit of casual play from Sterling, a little bit of noise with himself. Things not quite going right behind the scrum for Hull, Alec.
Well, I don't think they're going right for Hull, Ray, but the New Zealand's contingent on the Hull side, Dane O'Hara and Fred Okoye and Lou Light, they're having absolutely a nightmare of a game. This is a graveyard for players, and internationals or no internationals, this finds them out.
Well, there's a long time to go, and here's Fred now. Oh, good ball to Kemble. But an equally good tackle, tremendous cover tackle from David Stevenson. Right round the legs, Sterling moving the ball to Cruz. Sean Patrick. And there's his opposite number again, Nicky Kiss. How many times have we seen those two together? Peter Sterling. 20 minutes to go in this final. Wigan commanding lead, 28 points to 12. Oh, good ball from Norton. Can Evans get away? No, he came back inside. I don't think he realised that the gap was there. But again, a good cover from tackle from Graham West to Devorty. And the sixth tackle. Kevin James to Schofield. McCoy. Oh. Just couldn't get the ball away. Good crash tackle came in. And a knock-on. Graham West just having the magic sponge. Graham West, he's not going off. It'll take more than a knock, I think, to get this Wigan skipper off the field. Wigan ball. It's locked. Put Michael forward. Well, he went in and found it. Good play here from the Wigan side, forwards, taking the ball away. Danny Campbell from the blind side, taking it away from the post, not risking any chances of kicks at goal for Hull. Settling the game down. And it's surprising, Alec, when you think that Hull have won these scrums 8-4, yet Wigan have such a commanding lead.
Yes, but that is all down to fitness, Ray, and obviously the way Wigan have played today, they would have beat any team in the country. They've absolutely played some magnificent football and played as a team where Hull have just been playing in ones. They've not been supporting a man with the ball, and that is the reason for this scoreline.
To Stevenson. Well, Kevin James got all of it well this time. That was a hard tackle. I think Kevin James felt that. He did. Akon, Lulua. well, to Hull's credit, keeping that ball going, keeping it moving. Yes. Peter Sterling. Oh, beautiful sidestep. Norton looking for support. He's got Kemba with him. To Kevin James. Can he make it to the line? No, good cover tackle from Sean Edwards. And he even comes up with the ball, does that Wigan youngster. Confidence there of an 18-year-old. Many consider that in future he'll be a half-back, but what a fine game he's having as a full-back. Scrum now, and Wigan ball. I think those 2 foot rolls having difficulty getting a grip on this very, very hard ground. Oh, and a good whole heel to Sterling. To Kemble, well linked up. Schofield. Oh, that was hard luck. He made the gap, he made the overlap, and just couldn't get the ball away. But good rugby from Hull, Sterling. Oh. A yard from the Wigan line. Steve Norton looking for the short pass, he gets it, and he's in, yes, James Luluai. Sean Edwards was worried about crossing, but a lovely piece, sleight of hand, puts hope again in the Hull fans.
Well, it's a very good try by Hull, a lovely ball out here to Stevie Norton, who loves this ball out here, just uses a foil, Paul Rose comes crashing on top of the ball, he's a big man this, just draws in John Ferguson and slips a lovely ball out to James Luluai for a very simple chance.
And just when we think, Alec, that all are down and dead, back they come at 28-16. Difficult kick for Crooks on the 25-yard, 15 yards in. But not striking them well. Lee Crooks only got 2 out of 5 attempts, not hitting the top form. Hasn't been kicking all season. Gary Schofield's been the man doing the job. I'm rather surprised they've not got him kicking the goals. Minutes left. Can Hull come back? They have the skill, they have the talent. To Steve Norton. And what a fine game was this veteran forward had. Played all over the world, Manly in Australia, 2-3 Great Britain tours. And still here, directing operations in the Hull Park. He likes to use the blind side of this John Muggleton a lot. Sterling again. Well, no support. And I think that's been the difference there, that pass from Peter Sterling, looking for support. The forwards should be coming off him. Now they're doing it. Gary Devorter. Yes. Oh, lovely ball from Crooks. Still going, Luluai, Evans. Well, I don't think Steve Evans quite meant that. I think he was looking for the kick and chase. Yes, he's grinning to himself. Not quite what I intended, lads. But at least it puts Hull on the attack again, Alec.
And just looking at some of these forwards now, Ray, on the Wigan side, even though they're winning 28-16, some of them look as though they're getting a little tired. It's very, very hot out there, and maybe the heat is having its toll on some of the players.
Yes. Many of us were saying this morning at the stadium how cold it was, and yet the temperature really has risen, hasn't it?
Well, I'm just looking at Sean Edwards, the Wigan fullback. He's actually tore his sleeves out of his jersey. He must be very, very hot for him to do that.
Yes, setting a new short sleeve style. Wigan in possession. famous cherry and white jersey of Wigan. Making a record 17 Challenge Cup final appearances here, looking for a record 7th win to equal Widnes' score, but still many minutes to go. Danny Campbell. Oh, good pass out to Nicky Kiss. What a fine game this hooker has had. To Kenny. Chip kick. Well, it looked a knock on, but I think referee Campbell allowed the advantage. What did he vote? Only a youngster, this number 13, but already in the Great Britain squad to train this summer for the New Zealand tests in October and November. And here's one man we've been looking for in the New Zealand tests. James Luluai to Sterling. Schofield. But these forwards are it, they're not coming up fast enough on these passes.
It's just the lack of a yard, Ray, and Wigan looked that little bit sharper. But I have heard rumours that Wigan are actually on 2,800 a man plus a £1,000 bonus, so you can understand why they don't want to stop playing. This must be the highest pay packet ever been paid out in a rugby league match.
And you and I played for £100 in 1966.
We played for the glory, Ray.
I'll believe you, Alec. To Ford. Rick Kenny. Oh, beautiful ball to Graham West. There was a hint of a high tackle there. To Kenny again. Distributing, looking for the wing. He's got Ferguson with him. Interesting to see that the temperature of the crowd, the atmosphere, lifts degrees when this boy Ferguson has the ball. Devolta. Campbell looking to bring Schofield inside. And let's give credit to Graham West, this number 11, New Zealand captain for Wigan. Tremendous tackling stint he's done. To Courtney. Ferguson again. Steve Evans moved on the wing to Mark Ferguson in the absence of O'Hara. And this is the sort of rough and tumble that Danny Campbell likes. He's used to this more in the mud of Auckland, Carlo Park. 10 minutes to go. Wigan still comfortably in the lead, 28 points to 16.
I think we'll find out now, Ray, that Wigan will want another try just to really clinch this game, because they know that they've got that extra yard. If they score now, it's curtains.
Just couldn't get the ball away, Brian Dunn. Looked to be another try on the cards if he could. Michael Ford. Oh, interception from Luluai. He looks to be well covered, though. Look at his Schofield's brought clear. Excellent tackle from Sean Edwards. I thought Schofield had brought him clear. And a penalty, yes, and rightly so. Edwards committing the soccer equivalent of a professional foul. Holding Schofield down, stopping the movement of play. Only a youngster, but an old head on his shoulders. Oh, and that's a good kick. Nine minutes left. Peter Sterling urging his men on. This time, he says. To Sterling. Oh. Almost there himself. 5 yards there from the Wigan line. To Crooks. No. Oh, good ball. But very, very well read there by David Stevenson. How well he's come in from the centre position, cutting off play in midfield. Devoted. Oh, no, they've got to score here. They've got to score. They've got to do something. Peter Sterling. Back to Devoted. Just can't get the ball out. Nicky Kiss clamping the ball there. Back to Sterling. Oh, good ball to Mullerton. No! Just stopped on the line. Good tackle from Ian Potter. Schofield again. A chip. No, hasn't got it. Stevie Donlan, good cover from Steve Donlan there, the Wigan centre, number four, spotted the kick through. Saved the try. This ex-league player, Wigan signing for £25,000, just 24 hours before the cup register. But the pressure still on Wigan. Kevin James. Sensibly bringing the ball in field. Six tackles to play with, he'll not want to be tackled into touch. No. Driving for the gap. Notice Nicky Kiss all the time, clamping the ball on Steve Norton, not letting him get the ball out. Oh, good driving run. Sean Patrick, whole crowd roaring them on. This is the time they must score. Sterling looking for the try himself. Oh. John Muggleton just mistimed his run coming up. Muggleton to Devorty. Is he in? Yes, he is. Quick play the ball. Substitute Gary Devorty. 19 years of age. Come on, hold that banner, says. And they're coming back. We thought they were down.
Well, is this going to be a grandstand finish or not? Hold the same. We might be down, but we're certainly not dead. Quick play the ball here. A lovely ball from Peter Sterling. Devorty shakes off one tackle, and he's right back in the game.
Yes, and what a thrill for that youngster, from the Huath Amateur Club in York, bringing Hull back 28 points to 20. And with 6 minutes left, this kick from Gary Schofield, a regular kicker. 105 goals to his credit this season. A vital one. No. Just missed. And gives Wigan that.
Well, this is good rugby by Hull. You know, they're not out of this game. A lovely ball again from Sterling. Holds the ball for Devorty. Just shakes off David Stevenson. And as he gets away, the line comes just for him.
Huge roar greeting the kickoff now. Wigan fans urging the side to hang on. 5 minutes gone. Can Hull do it? Five minutes to go. Hull certainly now looking to be moving this ball out. But only one side have ever come back from a 10-point deficit. That was Leeds, but can Hull do it? Oh, yes, and Lulawai's going straight through. He's taking everybody by surprise. A tremendous try. Oh, the game now is alive. What more could we want? We wondered whether Hull could do it, and here they are showing us.
Well, are we going to see this finish? What a game this is. This must be one of the best cup tie that's ever been at Wembley. There's a quick play of the ball here. John Muddleton gets up, plays the ball quickly. Just now, Gary Schofield whips the ball out here to James Lulai. He absolutely blisters onto this ball, and this is another class try. If we had a try of the season, we'd have them all in these games. Just watch him. I think he will be a little bit disappointed. He's not gone near to the post, but have we got a turning point?
4 minutes left, and if ever Gary Schofield wanted a goal, this was it. Can he narrow the gap to 2 points? It's still a difficult kick, and he's missed it. Well, I think at the end of the day...
Well, this is it again, and Hull never say die. It's a lovely try here from Frederick Coy, moves the ball out to James Lulai, his fellow countryman. And this fella, he's got class and he's got pace. It's the first time we've seen him stretch his legs, but there's no doubt what he's going to do with this one. This one's a try all the way.
And I think at the end of the day, if Wigan win this Silk Cup Challenge Cup, it'll be those five missed goals from Hull that will do it. 10 valuable points gone begging there. 3 minutes left, 4 points difference. And Wigan, I'm sure, will want to keep Hull down here. Lee Crooks driving in. John Patrick. Ball used up, three tackles already. They've not made a lot of ground. To Norton. Just couldn't get the ball away, Paul Walsh. Stevie Norton, what a game that veteran loose forwards had. Played as well as ever I've seen him. Peter Sterling, one last trick out of the boot. Oh, and it's a good kick. Pushes Sean Edwards back. But Wigan have possession. Just almost 2 minutes to go. And Wigan will want to hold on to this ball. They'll play the six tackles through. They'll take it to the sixth. Henderson Gill. Weaven, dodging. He's still going into that. Oh, what a fine game he's had. Both of these sides know now one vital slip could cost the cup. Ryan Dunn. But what a performance these two sides are giving. Must be one of the finest Challenge Cup finals in its 50-year history here at Wembley. Oh, and that's a good kick. That's a superb kick at this stage in the game from man of the match, the Lance Todd Trophy winner, Brett Kenny, all the way from Parramatta in Australia. All of his ambitions to play here, and he takes the trophy for man of the match home with him. Tremendous applause from the crowd at the honour. 1 minute left. Hull desperate to get that ball in the scrum and get it away. A try and a goal could still seal the game for Hull. Oh, and Young forward. Just look at those little terriers. Tigers fighting for the ball. They know that possession is nine-tenths of the game at the moment. He says, I'm marking you, Sterling. I'll let you know I'm playing. But a great battle between the two. 30 seconds to go. To Sean Edwards, he's got a 2-1 over that. Kenny on the outside. John Ferguson looking to see that. I think he's troubled. Yes, he is. Looks like a hamstring injury. Ian Potter, four tackles to go for Wigan. Graham West driving it near the line. Wigan, Ferguson, he looks to be hampered by that leg injury. 40 minutes and up, we're in injury time now. Brian Dunn. Wigan will be content just to keep the ball down here. They've got the 4 points. To Kenny. Dunn. Oh, he's lost it. Lulawai. We're in injury time, it's going to take a 70-80-yard try to do it. But Hull have the stars capable of doing it. Cooks moving it to the wings. Oh, to Akoi. Now he's got Steve Evans. Beat one man. He's beaten two men, still going. Oh, and there's the hooter. What a game. My well, the Wigan players leap in the air. An incredible match. 28 points to 24 for Wigan. And I don't think they can believe it. That last chance from Steve Evans. The cover just got him. But let's give credit to both teams. And Henderson Gill, he's delighted, he's overjoyed. And Nick Dutoit, the substitute. Henderson Gill in tears there, looking at the crowd. And Wigan, for the first time for 20 years, have got the cup back at Central Park, Wigan. And let's give credit to that whole team. How well they've played. What a contribution they've made to this final. There was something special about the 50th Wembley before we started, and now it's proved the point. Wonderful exhibition, Ali.
Well, I think we've just witnessed, Ray, probably one of the greatest final that's ever graced Wembley. And both sides, you've got to say, have contributed a lot. Wiggins played some excellent football, and this man here, he's won the Lance Todd Trophy. Seagar has just won the... He must have skimmed the book, is this fella. 3-1 to win it, and what a great job he's done.
Yes, and the final... Let's give praise to this lad, Peter Sterling. His ambition was to play at Wembley. He's upset, but what a sportsman. Acknowledges the winners. 10 tries shared between the two teams. And these Hull players, they've given everything. It just wasn't quite good enough. But they've contributed to a spectacle. And so the hoodoo that surrounds Hull of never having won at Wembley still goes on. But Wigan, a record 17th Challenge Cup final, record 13th appearance at Wembley, and now a record 7th Wembley win. And it's been very hot down there, players drinking orange juice, drinking water. They've given their all. And that youngster there, Michael Ford, number 7, what a fine game he's had. Many people thought he might be overawed playing against Stirling, but what a fine advert for the British Amateur Rugby League. Gary Campbell pleased to get on. Wigan on the way to receive the cup, and I'm sure many people will be thinking back to 1951 when the New Zealander Cess Mountford last received the cup for Wigan. And here is one of his products, a man that Cess Mountford, the old Wigan captain, coached, Graham West, all 6'5" of him, being presented with the Silk Cup Challenge Cup trophy by the Earl of Derby. And what a way to celebrate the 50th Wembley. Tremendous role for Graham West. They've waited 20 years for this. 40,000 of them travelled down from Lancashire. And it's been worth waiting for. Customary raising of the cup for the team. Neil Courtney. And Graham West looking for somebody in the crowd, possibly his wife. We've done it, he says. And a kiss from David Stevenson. Wigan came with a sense of vengeance. They lost last year, they felt they'd disgraced themselves. But my word, what a contribution they've made to this final. Danny Campbell, 15 stone from Auckland. Stevie Donlan, only been with the Wigan club 4 months. And Henderson Gill, wingman supreme, goal kicker, entertainer. Having a word with Jack Hilton, the Wigan club chairman. Whoops! Oh, lost me footing, says Henderson. Tremendous scenes, tremendous appreciation from the crowd. And the man, Lance Todd Trophy winner, Brett Kenny, man of the match. The Earl of Derby just having a word with Brett Kenny. And none more pleased than Wigan chairman, Jack Hilton, on the Earl of Derby's right. All smiles, and Nicky Dutoit, the substitute from South Africa. He watched Wigan play last season on the television. He put a telephone call into Wigan, he said, can I have a trial? And here he is walking down the steps with the cup. Henderson, Gale and Ferguson, the two wingmen. Tremendous tries, as good a tries, I think, as we've seen at Wembley. And Nicky Kiss, number 9. And I don't think anybody's ever going to get that cup off Michael Ford, Alec.
Well, what a lovely, but what a great tribute you've got to pay to this side. You've got to be a loser, and sorry to say, it's got to be Hull again. Doesn't this fella look sick? But what a great game it's been. You've got John Muddleton here, Steve Evans. They know they've let the supporters down, but I think they can hold their heads high, because this has been a truly magical game. And Kevin James here, up from the valleys, he can be proud of himself. Gary Campbell, I think they've all done their part.
Yes, there's no disgrace, Alec, in this. No disgrace at all. And referee Ronnie Campbell kept up a fine tribute from winners. They've had 4 referees in the final. George Phillips, Robin Whitfield, Mick Norton, and now Ronnie Campbell. And it takes a referee to make a game like this. He's had his contribution. And those two touch judges there, Mr. Norbury and Mr. Irvin. And that's what it's all about. The Silk Cup Challenge Cup for 1985. 28 points to 24 for Wigan. A name renowned throughout the world, those famous cherry and white shirts. Delighted. Gary Campbell passing the orange around. And a tremendous, colourful scene here. They've got Australians in the side, South Africans, New Zealanders, Wales, a truly international win. And that's what they think about it all. Brett Kenny and Fergie, the two Australians. They've been well worth the investment for Wigan. And it's held a lot. Graham West, 6 foot five of him, from the Auckland club in New Zealand. Particularly wanted to win this cup after his mentor, Cess Mountford, who last held it by a New Zealander in 1951. And truly, a wonderful Wembley, a Wembley to celebrate the 50th. Looking to move off on the traditional lap of honour, and how well they deserve it. And I think that sums up the game, Alec, there. The black and white cap on the red and white jersey.
Well, I think so, and how hard did work for it and how hard did deserve it, because what you've got to think now, the season's not over for these lads. They've got another game on Tuesday. They might celebrate with a little bit of champagne tonight, but I think tomorrow morning, Alan McInnes will be saying, you've got to get back to training. Well, let them enjoy the moment because they'll remember it forever.
Yes, yeah, somehow the Wigan fans have got over those barriers, but it's not in animosity, it's in sheer joy. They've waited a long time. Interesting, Wigan last won the cup in 1965, and one of their coaches, Colin Clark, was playing. So he's got the experience now of picking up the cup as a player and as a coach. Red and white favours everywhere, red and white flags, red and white hats, or cherry and white, I should say, the traditional colours of Wigan. And David Stevenson, hardly seen for that hat.
I think they'll be saying there, you know, some of these lads will be saying, let me touch the cup, we've waited for it for a long, long time. They may never see it again for a long time, but they're going to savour this moment. It'll take them a long while to get to the other end of the tunnel, but when they get there, what an ovation. Just listen to this as they come to the Wigan supporters. Just listen to this roar. This will absolutely bring Wembley down to it, absolutely to the bricks.
Yes, 40,000 crowd, full-throated roar. Tremendous atmosphere. I don't think we've seen scenes like this for many, many a year. The Rugby League needs a strong Wigan, the cherry and white heroes, and they will be when they get back to Central Park, their home, tomorrow afternoon. And Graham West, acknowledging the support and the fervour that that crowd have given. Brett Kenny is Wigan's peer, and he's proved it. There's a gill, there's a way. Well, there are one or two wags in Wigan. They're in good humour. No doubt about it, this support have carried them through the season. We've seen the resurgence of a Wigan team again. That cup looks to be in danger of going under that melee of supporters. A vast number of Wigan heroes took part in the parade of stars. Billy Boston, Jack Hilton, Eric Ashton, Mick Sullivan, and I'm sure from this 50th Wembley there are going to be a few more stars, Alec.
And when you think, Ray, just imagine that in Billy Boston's pub tonight, all that lot will try to get in. They'll be giving free beer, champagne, and Billy will certainly need a few extra bottles of lager.
Yes, and Ian Potter, Brian Case, what a credit to the Blackrock Amateur Club of St Helens who produced these two players. Both done their stint in the Wigan Pack this afternoon. Ian spotted somebody in the crowd. Pigeon just alighted on somebody's hat there. Neil Courtney. And what joy, what happiness for that youngster there, Brian Dunn, drafted into this Wigan side just a few weeks ago, and injured Sean Wayne. And let's not forget men in the Wigan squad, people like Brian Dulieff, who scored that never-to-be-forgotten try in the semi-final at Elland Road, put Wigan on the way to Wembley.